Sadness and Laughter, an excerpt from Meditation Times, October 2011. We fail to understand various emotions when they arise. We fail to recognize how to get out of those emotions. The process of meditation does not mean that you come, sit down for an hour with closed eyes, maybe you fell into a deep sleep. Certainly that will make you more relaxed, but that is not meditation. You are not growing into awareness. Meditation means any understanding that transforms your consciousness, brings a deeper understanding in you. This is why all these talks are relevant, because firstly it brings an understanding to you, and with that understanding you get a different perspective looking at the situations, circumstances and various emotions when they arise in us. Therefore this is a process of transformation. You are not conversed with the silence as yet, so the words have to be used as a trap. You know, one of the most beautiful mystic, female mystics in Sufism, Rabia Basri, she was one of the most beautiful women. Once a very rich person from Iran came to Basra. Basra is a city in Iraq, and he inquired from the people, is there anything precious in this city or most beautiful? He said yes. The people said in one voice, yes, there is. Where can I find? Inquired the rich man. The people said, in the brothel. So he was surprised, how can I find the most beautiful thing in the brothel? But yet still he went. He was full of passions. He goes there, the matron charged a very high price for him to enter Rabia's room, and there he saw a totally different thing, a state of prayerfulness, a temple, a globe. Something magnificent he saw that dazed his eyes. Rabia was sitting with her face towards the other side. But that beauty captivated him. Thereafter, when the prayer finished, Rabia looked at him. Those lotus eyes, when he looked into, he was mesmerized. Those lotus eyes. And he said he came full of passion. But the passion was totally transformed in the presence of Rabia Bisbee. And then he said, I am your slave, I am at your feet. Tell me what you want me to do. Do you know what did Rabia tell him? Rabia said, if you have, whatever you have experienced here, whatever you have seen here in this presence, do not make a mention of this outside when you go out of this room. Do not make a mention of this to anyone. The man became even more curious. Why? He said that this is the reason that Rabia said that I take promise from everyone whosoever visits me not to go and narrate it to anyone, not to explain this experience to anyone. This is the way the beauty of Rabia Bisbee trapped the people. They have heard the beauty of Rabia Bisbee. They came to know that she is in the brothel. They came, and when they came, the beauty trapped and they were transformed. That was the way of Rabia Bisbee. Each master uses traps. His words, his presence is a trap. Because of the words being so captivating, so full of wisdom that you are captivated by it, you are trapped. And when you come and you listen to the words and all that surrounds the word, that is the energy field of the master. Through the words you are entering the energy field of the master, and that is what transforms the energy. So Rabia said, do not go and tell what you have experienced here in this room to anyone. When you try to go deeper into the words, this becomes meditation. You can enter into any emotions that inflicts upon you, be it sadness, be it anger, be it frustration, be it doubt, be it anything. And emotions can be positive and negative, both, it does not matter. And when you go deeper into it, that negative emotion, which everyone looks at it in a negative way, is transformed and becomes a stepping stone for you to go beyond. For example, headache. Headache is a constant reminder to you that there is something, some issue, which you had been postponing, and in that process you have completely forgotten the main issue. And when it surfaces on the physical level, then you realize that there is a headache. And you feel that the headache is spreading all over your head. But if you meditate, you will realize the headache is only at a particular point. And that point relates to the issue that you have been postponing. So unless and until you go into that issue, you will not be able to, no doctor can cure your headache. Your headache is your own creating. Only you can find a remedy to it. And the remedy to any emotional disturbance lies in going deep into it, not forgetting it, not overlooking it, not putting it aside. Whenever anything like that comes, any issue like that comes to baffle us, we put it aside instead of going deep into it. And the entire process of meditation is going deep into the emotions. So this issue of meditation times for the month of October 2011 deals with sadness and laughter. Sadness is beautiful when you understand it. Sadness transforms you, transforms your consciousness when you make sadness a meditation. You will get surprised when I say make sadness a meditation. When you make sadness a meditation, You are going deep into it. And when you go to the core of your sadness, suddenly there comes a 180-degree turn. Suddenly the grip of sadness loosens. Sadness is on the surface as the outcome of inner unhappiness and misery. It is certainly the lack of understanding that makes your consciousness misery and sadness. Sadness gives depth. Sadness gives height. Sadness is like your roots, and happiness grows like numerous branches. Sadness is the roots, and happiness is the branches that grow out of that roots. Like a tree, happiness grows to reach into the stars in the sky, and sadness, like the roots going down deep into the womb of the earth. Sadness gives nourishment at the gross level, and the air and the sunlight of happiness brings subtle nourishment. Nobody knows why does a fruit ripes. A fruit ripes in the sunlight. This is why those fruits that are ripe, that ripe on the tree, are considered to be more precious than the fruits that do not ripe on the tree. Bigger the tree, bigger will be its roots, and the roots will be deeper. In fact, it is always in proportion, and that is the balance. The roots go deeper. The deeper the root go, taller the tree becomes. You have always looked at the things and phenomena wrongly. You consider sadness as something bad. You mean darkness is bad, and there should be no night and it's dark. It may sound same to you that darkness is bad and anything bad you should remove from your life. That means darkness is bad and there should be no night and it's darkness. Indeed, this is insane. Darkness of night is needed as much as the bright sunlight of the day. After the day's work, when tired, you sink into the darkness of the night to recuperate and rejuvenate. After the day's work, you sink into the darkness of the night and you recuperate and rejuvenate. Therefore, when sadness surrounds you, be really sad. Sink into it. Sink into sadness. What else can you do? It is already there. Nothing can be done. The more you try to avoid, the more sad you will feel. Sadness is needed. It is very relaxing. Like a dark night, it surrounds you. Fall asleep into it. Accept it. And you will see the moment you accept sadness, it starts becoming beautiful. Sadness is ugly because of your rejection. And as sadness is considered not ugly, something begins to happen. As such, sadness is not ugly. It is your perception that makes it ugly. Nothing is ugly or beautiful. It is your perception that makes it ugly or beautiful. Once you accept it, you will see how beautiful it is, how relaxing, how calm and quiet and how silent it is. It has something to give that happiness can never give. Sadness has something to give that no happiness can give. You cannot bring the balance otherwise. The balance that you bring is of no use. It will be forced. Balance that comes spontaneously on its own is beautiful. It is already there. In fact, when you are happy, you become so excited that it becomes time. Have you watched? The heart immediately moves then into the other direction, gives you a rest. You feel it as sadness. It is giving you a rest because you are getting too excited. It is medicinal. It is therapeutic. It is just as in the day you work hard and in the night you fall deeply asleep. Then when you get up in the morning, you are fresh again. After sadness, you will be fresh again, ready to be excited, ready to go and plunder your world. So too, sadness is the light, like the night of the demon, and happiness is the day of the day or the sunshine. Together, these nourish and nurture your consciousness. With awareness, when you enter into sadness, it becomes meditation. With awareness, when you enter into sadness, it becomes meditation. And when something, situation or emotion or feeling becomes meditation, the process of transformation begins with a new one. Meditation is the quality of your being, like creativity, that you bring to any activity, emotion or a state of mind. Meditation is the quality of your being, like creativity, that you bring to any activity, emotion or any state of mind. As such, you have been conditioned to consider sadness as negative. Sadness can become a very enriching experience with awareness. Once there is awareness, sadness can become a very enriching experience. You have never thought of that. That's why you have not known the depth, the essence and the beauty of sadness. You have to work on it. It is very easy to escape from your sadness. And this is what everybody does. This is what you have been taught to do. The moment you see the traces of sadness, you try to disappear. Get yourself engaged in something or the other. You go for a walk. You engage in some other activity, watch your television show. You always try to avoid the situation. The moment any emotion comes which has been taught to you as negative, you try to escape. All your relationships are ordinarily escapes. It is very easy to escape from your sadness, and that is what everybody does. All your relationships ordinarily are escapes. You simply go on avoiding it under one pretext or the other, and it is always there underneath, flowing like an undercurrent. Like the current, it continues waiting for any situation, wanted or unwanted, to explode. Many times you look at the situation, when people get angry, there is no reason for them to get angry. But that which has been hiding deep within surfaces on that at that moment. Then one tends to throw the responsibility on the other, but it is not the real thing. It is not the real thing. Instead, it is your own sadness transformed as your loneliness. It is your own sadness that is transformed into loneliness. You have not settled with it yet. So it erupts again and again, and you feel lonely all day. So sadness, because of the lack of awareness, lack of understanding, becomes loneliness. First you are sad, which is very trivial emotion. But when you try to escape from it, it deepens. Not that you are going deep into it. Instead, your sadness deepens. And then one day it becomes loneliness. You are feeling lonely. So then you try to come out of the trap of loneliness by entering into your relationship. You are entering into the relationship to avoid loneliness. Again, a next trap has come. You cannot enter into relationship out of your negative approach to life. When you are overflowing with joy, only then when you enter into relationship, that is a rewarding, that is fulfilling, that brings a tremendously a different type of a joy. So what you do, it is erupting again. You can escape in work, you can escape in some other occupation, in relationship and society, this and that, in traveling, but it is not going to go away because it is part of your being. You are born alone into the world, and alone one day you go, alone one day you come through the parents, all alone. So too you will die alone and move out of this world alone. And between these two states of loneliness, you go on deceiving and fooling yourself. It is good to take courage and enter into this loneliness. However hard and difficult it may look in the beginning, it pays tremendously. Once you settle it or start enjoying it or feel it not as sadness but as different form of silence, and you understand that there is no way to accept, you relax totally. Nothing can be done about it. So why not enjoy it? And when you tell someone asks you, how are you? I am very sad today, I am enjoying my sadness. The person will find that you are crazy or something else. This is how it happened. I have heard once a Sufi dreamt that angel came and told him that tonight devil is going to poison all the water of this town, and whenever anybody will drink that water, he will get mad. So you collect as much water as possible and do not drink that water. So it happened. In the morning when people drank the water, everyone got mad, but this Sufi did not drink the water, so he was seen. But when you are in the world where everyone is insane and you are the only sane, then your sanity becomes insanity because the masses are insane. So that which is mass, that which is all around, the whole perspective changes then. So all those people who had become mad, insane after drinking that water, they were in majority. So it is the rule of the fools. Fools are in majority. So the wise men are considered fool in that congregation. So everybody thought that the Sufi has gone mad because he is speaking a totally different language, as it will happen in the world dominated by your so-called insane people. the words of the mystic, the masters are considered as insane because they are bringing something of the beyond. They are speaking in a totally different way. They are speaking a totally different dimension. They are bringing a totally different understanding. They will certainly be considered as mad. But this is how it happens. But you have the responsibility for your own life, for your own truth, for your own understanding, for which no one else is responsible. You have to take your own step. The key is, whenever you feel sad, sit silently and allow sadness to surface. Do not try to escape from it. Make yourself as sad as you can. Do not avoid it. Cooperate with it. Cooperate with your sadness. Remember this. Cry and have the whole taste of it. Cry to death. Roll on the ground and let it go by itself. There is no force. There is no force that it can do. It will go on its own, because nobody can remain in a permanent mood. Nobody can remain in a mood permanently. This applies to all moods. Anger comes, it remains there for a while. You lock up yourself into the room. Then maybe hour, 2 hours after night, you open the door, you come out, a friend calls, anger disappears, and then suddenly you see the person who to you is the cause of the anger. It gives a glimpse, then the same old story starts. But this is not meditation. Because no permanent meditation, no mood can remain permanently. And this applies to all the moods. Remember, sadness is one mood. When it goes, you will be unburdened. When you try to avoid it, you will remain burdened. It will be needed. It will be indeed absolute relief, as if the whole gravitation has disappeared and you can fly. When you understand it, when you make it a meditation, that is the moment to enter into your remembrance. First bring sadness. Ordinarily you do not allow it. You are ready to find some ways and means that you can look somewhere else. So you go to the restaurant, to the swimming pool, meet friends, read a book, or go to a movie, play musical instruments. You go on doing something or the other. This is to keep engaged, and you can put your attention somewhere else to avoid sadness that is filtering into you. When you are feeling sad, do not lose the opportunity. Close the door, sit down and feel as sad as you can, as if the whole world is just a hell. Go deep into it. In the beginning it may sound difficult, it may sound crazy, but unless and until you go into it, you will not know the beauty of it. You will not know the elegance of it. You will not know the fragrance of it. You will not know the transforming capabilities of it. Allow every sad thought to penetrate you, every sad emotion to stimulate. Allow every sad thought to penetrate you. Allow every sad thought to penetrate you, every sad emotion to stimulate you. And cry and weep and say things, and say them loudly. There is nothing to worry about, because unconsciously you say many things loudly. We call it murmur, or we call it grumble. But do it consciously. So first live sadness for a few days, and the moment that momentum of sadness goes, you will feel very calm, and peaceful. It is like one feels after the storm is over. It is like one feels after the storm is over. In that moment, sit silently and enjoy the silence that is coming on its own. You have not brought it. You are bringing sadness, and when sadness disappears, in the week, silence settles. Listen to that silence. Close your eyes. Feel it within. Feel the very texture of it and fragrance to it. And if you feel happy, then sing and dance. If you feel happy, then sing and dance. When sadness and sorrow overtakes you in life, this implies that you have taken a wrong step. Suffering implies that you have gone astray and there is discontent. The suffering is only a pointer. Do not make it your lifestyle. Do not become masochist. For masochism is a disease for which many people suffer. Any moment of great happiness will also be a great moment of sadness. The meditator looks at everything, but he does not escape. Whatsoever passes is good. Sometimes happiness comes, sadness, anger, and jealousy follow. You need not make them your problem. Just go into it, whatever be the emotions. So you have the attitude as if you are waiting at the airport in the waiting lounge. You are at the airport waiting, sitting in the waiting lounge. So many people come and go, good and bad, saint or sinner, black and white, men and women. Is it any of your concern? You simply sit in your chair and concern. You are waiting for your flight and not at those people's flight. The person who is sitting next to you in the waiting lounge is waiting for his flight, not your flight. He is not concerned with your flight. He is not concerned with your luggage. You are waiting for your flight and these people are not coming for you. So why to bother about you? You continue to engage in your awareness. If sadness comes like the ugly people, let it come. Stay there for a few moments, as long as it wants to stay. The person who is sitting next to you has come on its own and will disappear from there when it's time for his flight comes in. When there is a call for his flight, then he will disappear from there. You did not invite him. You did not tell him to go. So too, these emotions are like those unwanted people. They come and sit down next to you. And you feel that they have infiltrated into your privacy. No. You watch the people. They are not bothered about whether anybody is sitting or not. They continue to engage in their own activities. Watch at in these public places. A person who is engaged in their own intimate acts, are they aware of your presence or your presence is creating any disturbance to them? Decide for yourself. Certainly not. They are not bothered whether you are there or not. So why to be bothered about these unwanted guests? And the people who are coming, because you are in the public, your mind is a public place, is a public lounge where anything invited, wanted or unwanted, invited or invited can come. It has become a public place, not yet as a private lounge. Then all these unwanted people will come They will come and stay there as long as they need to stay. And the moment when somebody is sitting down next to you, you are ready to go to the to have a bite to the rest of them. But the people engages you in activity, in talk, and you remain in that, and you forgot that you had decided that you wanted to go to have something to drink or something to eat before you board the plane. You forget, and same time the call comes in. Call for your flight comes in and you have to leave. You forget about it. You are waiting for your flight and these people are not coming for you. You do not even know who they are. You are there. You are not there to judge who is good and who is bad. Because you judge only when you think it is your home. That lounge is your not home. So too your mind is not your home. So do not bother, because the whole world has been directed to create false characters and morality. A master is not interested in any character or morality as such. I am not telling people to be immoral. Instead, I am telling them to be conscious and to create more and more consciousness. The more consciousness you create, the more meditative you are. Indeed, a meditator can never be sad. If meditation has really happened, there can be no sadness, there can be no kind of emotion that can disturb your consciousness. Whether it is anger, whether it is frustration, whether it is anything else, it cannot disturb you, disturb your serenity. If your serenity, if your silence is fake, then any little situation comes in and it will disturb. If meditation has really happened, there can be no sadness. No emotion can disturb your serenity. However, throughout the entire past of humanity, we have created sad scenes and scenes. It has been like a nightmare. Now we need cheerful scenes, cheerful faces. Saints who are capable of love and laughter, whose very presence creates laughter. Sufis have created the character of Mullah Nasruddin. I have heard once some friends ask Mullah Nasruddin, "Mullah, how old are you?" Mullah, very in his own unique way, he said, "I am 40. The person said, 2 years ago when I asked you, you told me the same age, that I am 40. Mullah said, "That is true. I always stick to my words. If I say something, I stick to my words." This is where Mullah looks at his own, makes a fool out of himself. And that is the greatest beauty. If you can laugh at your own folly, at your own words, there can be no better meditation than that. But usually people laugh at the others. Someone slips on a banana skin and falls, you immediately burst into laughter. And you laugh because your life is so much bored that you are so much bored, so much that you have no control over it. So you burst into laughter. This laughter is not transparent. You look at the people when they are laughing. They are laughing to cover up their boredom. They are laughing at others, but they are not laughing at their own. All the Sufi jokes of Mullah Nasruddin, because it was Richard Merrill who brought Mullah Nasruddin into United States and make him alive once again. Richard Merrill was a puppeteer, person who was engaged in puppet show, and he brought the character of Mullah Nasruddin and make him alive. And since then he has become the source to adorn every society, every place. The jokes of Mullah Nasruddin are full of wisdom, and it is called device fool. It was Idrisha, the Sufi mystic, who brought him into life. We have to know there is the types of laughter. If you go into meditation, if you make sadness as meditation, you are moving into the dimension of celebration. Life is to celebrate. Only this much for this morning. Laughter is another dimension that I will take in tomorrow's session. So until then, take care and have a pleasant day.